many, if not most, probably most, of our best known and most admired Bible characters are people who lived in adverse circumstances. And the people of Israel as a whole sort of show part of the problem, possibly from the other angle. When Israel was at peace and prosperous, that invariably led to a decline in faithfulness in Israel. It might take a generation or two, but the decline always came. It was when they were oppressed, when they were suffering, when times were hard, that they began turning back to God. The stories that we know best, particularly Old Testament stories, are stories that didn't happen in a vacuum. Things were happening, real things. There is always a context that made things more real to the people who live those experiences than to those of us who just read about them. It's easy to read it without realizing what they were really going through. Often the best known stories are the ones we teach to our children. And maybe it's because we're teaching the story to our children that we tend to sanitize the stories a little bit. We minimize the gory or the ugly backstory. We present the nice story, one that's, you know, okay to tell to kids. For example, the story of the birth of Jesus, I think, is a good example of that. We have the baby Jesus, no crying he makes, lying in clean swaddling clothes, placed in a nice, neat manger. We don't have smell of manure in the stable. And we certainly don't dwell too much on the massacre of all the other baby boys in the village of Bethlehem. There's some ugly part to that pretty story. Those difficult circumstances often placed the star characters in a foreign environment, one that was not their own. It's interesting to notice is how often the main person in some of our best-known stories and our best-known characters, how often that main person is in one way or another in an alien situation where he or she is the alien. That's the way Abraham is described in Hebrews chapter 11, reading just verses 9 and 10. By faith he dwelt in the land of promise, as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents. When you read about someone dwelling in tents, it means they don't have a home. They keep moving. They don't own stuff. They just have their tents. Dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Abraham was childless. He didn't own one square inch of land, had no land to call his own. And yet God told him that he would have so many descendants that he wouldn't be able to count them, and that his descendants would own all the land he could see. He had to have faith that the land in which he was then a foreigner would someday belong to his people. But at that time, he was the foreigner. The great story of Joseph is set in the context of Joseph becoming and being an alien in a foreign country. His own brother sold him into slavery. In Egypt, he has his ups and downs, but they included long periods in a very unpleasant Egyptian prison. But in that prison, he learned to trust God, to care for him, and to take care of his family in what would always be for them a foreign land. In my Bible reading this past week, and you may be on a similar schedule, you're reading in the book of Exodus, read the story of Moses. He was already a foreigner in Egypt. He was born a foreigner in Egypt. And then he had to leave that land to become a foreigner in the land of Midian. And there's where he found a wife. When they had a son, he named his son Gershom. For he said, I have been a stranger in a foreign land. Gershom resembled the Hebrew word for stranger or foreigner. He named his kid foreigner because he had lived all his life as a foreigner in a strange land. Moses never lived in his homeland. Josh is leading the class on Sunday morning in 1 Peter. 1 Peter was written to Christians who, as far as faith was concerned, were foreigners on earth. He addresses it to pilgrims, sojourners, people who are aliens where they are. God's people were always the right people in the wrong place at the right time. They could never depend on their surroundings and could never depend on their circumstances to encourage them or to support them in faithfulness to God. They were always countercultural. Daniel is another of these stories about a man who was an alien in a foreign land. And Daniel's story doesn't necessarily, maybe it doesn't get sanitized as much as some other problems, but we still aren't always fully aware of the real situation in which the story of Daniel unfolds. Daniel is probably the best known, or his story is the best known of the stories of the prophets. But it's not because of his prophecies. The prophecies of probably Isaiah are better known than the prophecies of Daniel. But Daniel's story is probably better known primarily due to two specific incidents in his life. Daniel in the lion's den and his three friends in the fiery furnace. Again, it's the best known, one of the best known prophets, because we teach his stories to our kids. We grow up learning those stories. But Daniel's story occurred in a real life and very difficult situation. It's much more than just a young Israelite going to Babylon and becoming a famous and powerful person in the foreign country. A lot more going on than just that. Even on his very best days, Daniel was an alien in a foreign land. And on other days, he was the direct target of people who wanted him dead as a foreigner in their land. But when we look at the broader picture, we get a better grasp of just how amazing Daniel was. The lesson this evening is the first in a series, probably a total of 5 lessons about Daniel. And if I had to put a title in the series, it would be too long to be a real title, but it would be something along the line of Daniel, the faithful alien maintaining one's identity in a foreign land. You know, that's just too long for a title, but that's what this series is going to be about. Tonight, we'll hardly look at the book of Daniel itself. We need to look elsewhere to see what was happening in Israel and to Israel during Daniel's lifetime, and that will give us the context for the story. And then in the next lessons, we'll be getting into certain aspects of his life. Toward the end of tonight's lesson, I'll just give you a brief summary of the various topics and explain how they were influenced by the history that was going on around them. The story of Daniel actually doesn't start in the book of Daniel. But before we even look at the real beginning of the story, let's try to imagine the scene at the beginning of Daniel in modern-day terms. Imagine that the unthinkable actually happened. What many of us grew up fearing through the 50s and 60s, then we didn't have fear anymore, but let's imagine that it happened. The United States and Russia go to war. Not some proxy war in some remote part of the world, but real, direct, their army, our army, fighting each other. The only positive thing about this war is, for some reason, it does not go nuclear. So there's something left after the war. And then the real unthinkable, the Russians win. They defeat the United States, and then they occupy our territory. Washington, D.C. has been destroyed. And then, part of the occupation, they send scout teams who go into our high schools and identify and select the best and the brightest of our young men. And those young men are selected for a special career track in Russia. These men are taken to Russia and placed in multi-year education programs. They will be taught there the language and the customs, the traditions, the culture. They will be immersed in the culture of the conqueror. And once they graduate, they will be placed in very important jobs in their new homeland. They will not be treated as many others of the conquered peoples will be treated. They will be the elite. To make it very real, imagine that four of our young men over here are selected in that selection process, and they are chosen and sent off for this special indoctrination program. We would call that a brainwashing program. The Russians would call it education. That's what happened to Daniel and to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The Babylonians defeated Judah, and they selected the best and the brightest young men, and maybe some of the best and brightest young women. Think about women like Esther. And they were re-educated in Babylon to become Babylonians. The story of Daniel actually begins in 2 Kings. Daniel chapter 1 verse 1 says, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim," not Jehoiakin, there's one of those two, but "in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it." The story is told in 2 Kings chapters 23 and 24. There was a regional power struggle going on between the reigning power in the area, the Egyptians, and the rising power, the Babylonians. Israelite kings would always try to figure out who's going to win so they would know who to make an alliance with so that they would be privileged or at least protected somewhat when things shook out. And more often than not, they chose the wrong team. They chose the losers. In this case, that's what happened. The Egyptians deposed King Jehoahaz and replaced him with Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim accepted to pay tribute to the Egyptians, hoping they would protect Israel from the Babylonians, but it didn't work. The Babylonians end up winning, and Egypt becomes a second-rate power. And Jehoiakim, though in the process, has become the puppet king of the Egyptians in 609 B.C. 2 Kings 24, verse 1 helps us situate the story of Daniel. "In his days, Nebuchadnezzar," that's in the days of Jehoiakim, "in his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his vassal for 3 years, and he turned and rebelled against him." The book of Daniel starts in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim. That happens to be the first year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. That wasn't when Israel experienced their final defeat. That's not when Jerusalem was completely destroyed, but that was the beginning of the end. But that is when Daniel and his three friends were taken to Babylon. So they were among the first of the Israelites to be deported to Babylon. That had a downside, and they didn't know maybe all that was going to happen, but at the same time, it had a positive side. They had a head start on getting established and becoming someone before larger numbers of Israelites were brought in. It would be another 18 or 19 years before Nebuchadnezzar completely destroyed Jerusalem and tore down the temple. But that means, and this is where our backstory really gets interesting, that means that Israel was resisting domination and the Babylonians were retaliating against the rebellious Israelites while the story of Daniel is unfolding, after even Daniel comes to a certain level of prominence. And we have to wonder then if some of the attitudes we read about in the story of Daniel, the attitudes towards Daniel and other Israelites that created stories such as, let's get this guy out and put him in a lion's den, if those may have been in some way linked to the rebellions going on back in Palestine. It would have been easy for Babylonians, many of them, to conclude, we can't trust these Israelites, even the ones that have managed to get important positions in our country, such as Daniel. Or what would be the impact in Babylon when a new group of several thousand Israelites would be shipped in? All kinds of things going on as we read through the nice little story of Daniel. Other things and other Bible characters were also involved in this power struggle. I mentioned Esther a moment ago. We remember that Haman tried to kill every Israelite of the empire while Esther was queen. Now that probably was pretty much after the days of Daniel. Maybe Carrie can straighten that out for us a bit on Wednesday night. But it still shows this precarious status of the alien Israelites in the foreign land of Babylon. Even when they were influential and had power and prestige, it was always fragile. You never knew when the power would shift against them again. Daniel 1:21 says that Daniel's active career lasted until the first year of King Cyrus. So we start with Nebuchadnezzar, we end with Cyrus. The book of Ezra also begins in the first year of King Cyrus. He was the one that first authorized the Israelites to start returning to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple and rebuild the city. So Daniel probably died after the first groups returned to Jerusalem, maybe before the temple was actually completed. So as you're reading through the first chapters of Ezra, think Daniel is an old man now towards the end of his career and his lifetime that's going on about then. All of these stories, Daniel, Esther, Ezra, Nehemiah, all of them have some similarities. In all of them, there were Israelites in high positions in Babylon. In all of them, there were people who were always against the Israelites and looking for opportunities to do something bad to the Israelites. And when they had an opportunity and when they had the power to do it, they tried to do them harm. And so even when some of the Israelites were influential and respected, they were never fully accepted and certainly never fully trusted by everyone. In all of these stories, we find the Israelites struggling with questions of identity. First of all, these stories happened because Israel as a nation had been unfaithful to God. But even in those severely unfaithful times, there were people who were trying to be faithful. We might call them a faithful minority. There were people like Jeremiah and Daniel and Mordecai and others. These were people who remained faithful, even when all of their Israelite neighbors were not faithful. But when they ended up in Babylon, maintaining their identity as faithful Israelites became even more difficult than it had been back in their homeland. Old Testament Judaism was very attached to a geographical location. They needed to be in Israel to be fully functioning Israelites. As long as there was Jerusalem and as long as there was a temple, they knew who they were, and they could go to the temple, and they could offer sacrifices. And even if they couldn't, they knew that the priests were there taking care of business. But they couldn't do that in Babylon. And especially when Jerusalem was destroyed. And that's what Psalm 137 is about. Psalm 137 expresses the feelings of people like Daniel who had been removed from their geographic and spiritual reference points. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hung our harps upon the willows in the midst of it. For there those who carried us away captive asked of us a song, and those who plundered us requested mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? When you are all alone in a strange and pagan culture, when your best opportunities for success and advancement, even for survival, depend on assimilation, on getting along, how do you maintain your identity as a faithful child of God? We might not be in Babylon, but I imagine some of you feel like you're in Babylon at work some days when conversations go haywire. Or increasingly, our American moral standards isolate those with Christian moral standards. How do we keep our bearings? How do we remain identifiable, recognizable children of God in such a foreign setting? When all of the pressures are to blend in and not be too obviously different. That's the story we find, and that's the dilemmas we find in the story of Daniel. And we'll be looking at those. Here, this is what we'll be looking at over the next 4 weeks. We'll start next week in Daniel chapter 1. Those four teenagers found themselves as captives in a foreign land. But they are given an opportunity to do much better than just survive. They are among the privileged few who will enter the power elite of the country. All they have to do is assimilate, fit in, become as Babylonian as a native-born Babylonian. If they will just go with the program, not cause problems, they have a bright future. That's the background of Daniel chapter 1. How do the people of God maintain their identity in that foreign culture? The second topic is godly men of wisdom. Polytheists such as the Babylonians always had room for one more god. So if the Israelites wanted to keep on worshiping their god from back home, that's fine, go right ahead, no problem, we don't have any objection. But the Israelites needed to remember one thing. The God from back home had just gotten whooped. If the Babylonians, in their minds, if they had beaten the Israelites, that was proof that the Babylonian gods were more powerful than the God of Israel. And it was very tempting for an Israelite to think the same thing. So the rivalry wasn't over which gods were real gods. We would tend to think of it that way. Our God's a real God, your God's not a real God. That wasn't the issue for the Babylonians. Their debate was over which gods are the most powerful. My God can beat your God. That's the way it was laid out. So throughout the story, we see Daniel's God being challenged by the Babylonians. Can your God protect you if we put you in a fiery furnace? Can your God protect you if we put you in a den of lions? Whose God can do it, can pull it off? And one way this struggle is played out is in the area of wisdom. When kings have dreams that they don't understand, they call for the wise men. The wise men call on their gods, they study the stars, they interpret dreams, maybe do a little tea leaf reading, whatever. But then when the wise men can't deliver the answers, who comes to the rescue? Daniel comes to the rescue. But he makes it clear that his wisdom isn't his wisdom. It's God's wisdom. Lesson is, men of God are wiser than the men of the world. We'll talk more and think more about that. Third lesson, the prayers of Daniel. They are always worth studying. Daniel couldn't go to the temple to offer sacrifices, and he couldn't even go to Jerusalem to pray at the temple, but he could face Jerusalem. He could turn towards Jerusalem and pray to the God of Israel, and the God of Israel would answer. So prayer certainly helped Daniel maintain his identity and maintain his focus as a faithful Israelite. And finally, we'll look at the sovereignty of God. If there is one big lesson that runs throughout all of these stories, stories of Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, it is that God is in charge. Israel wasn't defeated because God was weak. And even though the Babylonians thought that the power of most gods was limited to a specific region, in the story of Daniel, the message is presented over and over that the God of Israel was powerful everywhere. He wasn't limited to Palestine. So they could be taken out of Palestine, and their God was still in charge. He still was sovereign over what was going on. When kings had these strange dreams, in those dreams, Daniel saw a message about the sovereignty of God. We're not going to look a whole lot at the details of the visions that we find there in the second half of the book of Daniel. We'll refer somewhat to them, but not look at them in detail. But among other things, we'll be looking at the main message, and among other things, those visions showed that even if Israel was captive in Babylon, and even if Jerusalem was in ruins, God still had a future for His people. And He would make sure that His plan happened. So the visions in the book of Daniel show that God is in charge and that His kingdom would prevail. In spite of being one of the chosen few, Daniel and his three friends lived at a horrible time for an Israelite. Their nation had been defeated. Family and friends, at least some, had probably been killed. We know nothing of his parents, whether they had survived or not. Jerusalem had been damaged and later would be completely destroyed. Probably their homes had been damaged, if not destroyed. They were removed from their families, deported to a strange country with strange customs. But men like Daniel were determined to maintain a distinct identity as the people of God. They weren't going to fight against their captors. Jeremiah told them, don't do that. But they weren't going to compromise their beliefs either. We will live peacefully in Babylon, but we are still Israelites, and we serve the God of heaven. That's a lot of the message we'll be looking at over the next few weeks. If you need to respond to the invitation this evening, we'll give you that opportunity. Let us know how we can help you in serving God, or if you need to become a Christian through baptism, let us know. Let's stand and let's sing.